I thought these people, see, this is an important point. I thought they were being unfair to me. What I want people to understand is in business, there is no fair and unfair. There are the people who make the fucking rules and the people who got to follow the rules. And depending on what position you're in, you're one of those two people.
Yo, I can't wait for y'all to listen to this episode. We're talking about how the streets have a huge correlation to corporate America, things that I've realized and seen, experienced. We are bringing them straight to you. We also talk about how there's a huge amount of patience and commitment, or a lack of patience and commitment, that is needed from people to get in and to develop business. We talk about in detail, and I can't wait for you all to hear from Johnny about the process, or the correlation of being feared and loved in business. I think you all gain a lot from that. And last but not least, we talk about expectations and establishing them amongst you and people inside of your business, and letting your expectations be the main thing of the business, and sort of knocking out all of the feelings and everything else that people kind of convolute business to, or inside of businesses. So sit back, listen, stay with us for the 70 minutes that we're on this podcast. And I hope that you all can take some notes and give us some feedback on one of our social media platforms.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Business and Biceps. And you better wake your ass up, because on today's show, we're freestyling. I can't wait to hear John Fosco rap today. He's probably not going to rap, actually. I hope he doesn't rap. I can't wait to hear what Maurice Clarett's got to say. And I got a few things to add myself. And of course, it's brought to you by MaxEffortMuscle.com. For all your supplement needs, you can build any three products in a free t-shirt for $100. And you can build any five products in a free t-shirt for $160 at MaxEffortMuscle.com. John, tell them about Podcast Influencer.
PodcastInfluencer.com is the domain. And it's the place you definitely want to go to if you have a podcast that you want to market. Because we all know podcast marketing, all of us who are in the game. It's tricky, man. Where do you put your marketing funds? How are you heard? Where are you seen? And we developed a product that is spot on when it comes to getting people the attention they need in podcasting. And we can also help you develop your idea into your own form of media, right? Into podcasting. So Podcast Influencer is kind of focused on the next new frontier of audio, and that's podcasting. And what we do is special. We have a product no one else has that is the most effective marketing product in podcasting. Reach out, find out about it at podcastinfluencer.com.
John, you're getting so much better at the reads. I'm just super impressed.
I mean, what did Rick Ross say? I'm a boss or something like that? Was that me? I don't know.
We're going to be freestyling. And this is what I like. So basically here's my plan, guys. Every one of you, including myself, have just one topic, maybe one story, or, you know, something that adds value. Like we always do with this top 10 podcast, which is Business and Biceps. And, I'm going to start with Mo, what do you got for the listeners today? I know you got some fire over there. Lay it down.
Yeah. So, this is, I don't know if this is a value, but it definitely helps, or it can help to raise awareness for some guys, right? And I was driving my daughter to school today, you know, and for no reason, I was just thinking to myself, like, the radio is off, you know, she was on her phone, you know, she's, you know, doing what she's doing. She watches her little morning shows or whatever she does on the phone. And I'm just riding and thinking, you know, I just came from the gym, and I was just thinking how similar, corporate America is to the streets. And I don't know why that came to my mind, but I was thinking like of a few different instances because
I love that your daydreams are this. First of all, I just gotta say that's amazing. But please continue.
Yeah, right. Because like, so I think like there's this, I don't know if you call it a misnomer, right? You think like, when you quit doing illegal activity that, you know, that you're just leaving this foreign process, like the way of thinking, how people treat each other, ethics, you know, and so much stuff that you believe that doesn't happen in the streets that you don't have that built-in infrastructure that's written down and people are not schooled. So you think that you leave it and you go to something else that basically has all of these rules and you have to behave a certain way and think a certain way. And your expectations for interactions amongst one another are completely different. But what I found out is that, you know, I came in ignorant with that misconception, like, hey, I'm about to walk into a space where people don't necessarily act like people in the streets. But, you know, I've got to say, I've been legit for 8 years now, like totally, you know, no crime, no, you know, mixing and moving, no nonsense. And over time, like, it would just start to hit me. I say, man, these dudes act like dudes in the streets. And so,
yes,
you know, one of the first places it hit me, like, even, and I don't want to throw a jab or a punch at them, but, you know, I would even deal with people in churches. You know what I'm saying? And even
that's the biggest hustle, Mo. Ooh. That's the biggest hustle. Are you kidding me? Have you ever heard of Joel Osteen, Mo?
Well, I've heard of Joel Osteen. Definitely have, but I was just saying, you know, my introduction to people in the church, you know, this is probably the most innocent platform that I think society thinks that you're most ethical and responsible and straight dealing people should be, you know what I'm saying? And I had dealings and I said, man, these dudes just think like dudes in the streets. They just don't have guns and consequences, or people just don't say what they want to if something doesn't happen because, you know, there's this veil of stuff. And then I've also been in business with people, you know what I'm saying? And I intentionally say, like, you know, there may be people in business who may occupy just a certain industry. It would be like these guys who occupy this industry, right? And then you'll recognize that there's opportunity over there. And then when you go over there, it's like, you know, they occupy that industry just like dudes in the neighborhood occupy blocks. You know what I'm saying? Like, I hustle my dope over here. I hustle my weed over here. I hustle my pills over here. And can't nobody come over here because this is my block. And the fact that you know it's money over here, I'm about to let you know, like, ain't nothing happening over here. And so I would see this stuff as I would move forward in business. And I say, man, the same mentalities that guys have in the streets is literally the same mentality that these guys have in the corporate world when it comes to business. And it actually encourages me to get more guys who are in the streets to say, my man, like, you know, you don't realize that there's no difference other than the product and the things that you're doing. Obviously, you can't have, you know, grave consequences and physically abuse people. But that was something and one of many examples that I was just want to talk about. That was like my thing, just understanding that the streets and the corporate world really have similarities with how they operate and the mechanics of them. That's all I was
saying.
Hey, Mo, can I ask you a quick question? Was there a situation to where something happened and you were like, I already been through this once, but the circumstances were this much different? Like, do you have like an example?
Absolutely. I can give you two examples. I can remember having an opportunity at a trucking company, right? That's when I started to do transportation. And literally I was starting to grow because I just had more capital. The more capital you have and the more you understand any industry, when you can scale up fast, you can basically beat up somebody who just doesn't have the capital that it takes to grow. And so I can remember, you know, people who would be above, like, rather be the general manager of the facility and people just having jealousy and not wanting you to grow. I can remember people aligning themselves together, be it other people who were independent contractors or general managers or just people within the system, and sort of like building this wall of like, no, motherfucker, you're not going past the space where you're going. And I say, man, this ain't nothing but just like hustling where, you know, you hustling. It's like, you know, I come to Columbus, Ohio, and I have enough money to buy, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 10, 20 birds, right? So I can go to anybody's block and become disruptive because I can sell my drugs cheaper. You know, I probably have an army of guys and I can do the same thing. But, you know, I've seen people can build united fronts where, okay, you know, this motherfucker may be coming out of town with all this dope, but I can go ahead and align all these other guys that I don't normally mess with, and we just gonna push this motherfucker out of here. You know what I'm saying? Rather we take them to war with guns, and whether we rob them, whether we shoot up their spot, whether we burn down their spot. And so I seen that same thing happen just within the legal world, where everything about what I did became super critical, because that was the justification on why we don't want you to grow. But it wasn't that. It was just, we don't want you to grow, so we'll put all these bullshit excuses out here, or we'll be super critical, and that'll justify our position. So they criticize in the legal world to stop growth and to justify why they don't want to give you. But in the streets, you're shooting dudes. And so it's the same situation, just different different consequences. You know what I'm saying? That's like, it's the same thing, though. And that's all I was, no, that's all I was getting at.
The one thing I would add on the streets front is, like, there's like a great case study. You know, everyone is aware of the fact that people call Chicago Chi-Raq now, you know, the West Side, South Side, most dangerous place probably in the country. And people say, why? What happened? What happened? Because it wasn't like that 15 years ago, right? Well, what happened is this. There was guys like Larry Hoover, and there was other guys who were bosses of the streets. There was about four of them. And the feds went in and they said, to dismantle crime, we have to take out the heads of the snake, which was probably the stupidest decision ever. And I'll take this back to business, because when you take out the heads of the snake, and let's say there's four snakes that literally control that whole area, you have fucking mayhem. You have every 16-year-old on every block trying to be the next Larry Hoover. See, if Larry Hoover was just in place, and these other guys who are leading the, you know, the GDs and all the vice lords, all this bullshit, like if they were in place, you would not have all these shootings. Why are these shootings every day? Because 15-year-olds and 16-year-olds want to make a name, but they do not have the infrastructure that these bosses had. These bosses had infrastructure where they knew, just like the mafia, right? Where they knew, if we are free of war, we're all making more money. When the guns start shooting, we're losing money, and it's just street shit. So there was a fine balance. But if you look at like what happened to Chicago, that's what happened. They took out the leadership, and now it's a free for all. It's a fucking free for all. And that free for all gives the government a reason to take away basketball courts, to take away schools, because they just say it's a fucking mess. We need martial law in here. Well, actually, everything there is counterintuitive. And the one more, the other thing I want to add on it is when you compare it to the corporate world, it's just like this, you know, the ultimate question, is it better to be feared or to be loved? I mean, people ask that all the time, because if you're feared, people stop and they listen to you. And if you're loved, they do it in a different way, and you can inspire. But when you have like church leaders and all these people who control groups of people, they control groups of people. They basically say, listen, you want to do business with me? I don't care if I represent the church or this or that or this business. You got to pay admission, motherfucker. I don't care what I represent. You better pay admission to get access to my people. If you don't pay admission in several different forms, depending on the person, you're not getting access to these people, and I don't know your name. So you choose. And that is exactly like the streets, but it's also being done in a respectful environment that we view as business. And it's really kind of sad.
Hey, so I was telling Johnny this story a little earlier, but so check this out. I was at the ballpark, and this lady we were talking about, her one son plays with Alex, and her other son wasn't there. He's a little younger. And she said, I was like, is your other boy play ball? And she goes, no. She goes, man, he just kind of wants to always do his own thing, and he don't really like – I don't know. He's just different. He's, you know, working on this project, gets really into it. Then he moves to another project. So I said to her, right? I go, sounds like you got an entrepreneur on your hands. And she goes, actually, I think you're right. She goes, he's got this. We got eight chickens. He got this. He got these eggs that are coming out, and he now won't eat any eggs because he don't want to mess up his profit. because he's selling eggs. So straight up, right? Most environments, whether we're here at Business and Biceps or I'm at the gym or whatever, I'm sitting in the middle of a bunch of parents at the ballpark that really probably have no clue what I really do. They really, you know, whatever. And so I say just freely, like, that's like the dope man, right?
Absolutely.
Hey, right. But in that situation, that was I'm talking about her 10-year-old kid hustling eggs in the middle of all these parents. So Rachel looks at me, right? It goes, it's not like the dope man. You're talking about her son.
It's exactly. So Rachel, I hope you listen to this episode.
It's just like the dope man.
It's exactly like the dope man. I sell weed so I can't smoke the weed because I'm smoking my profit. You know what I'm saying? It's exactly the same. It's the same skill set. It's the same mechanics. And I've said it on this podcast a million times over. You know, and even if you're a guy who sold drugs and now you're listening to the podcast and you want to get over it, just realize you do have a skill set. That little kid who's saving eggs, who doesn't want to eat his profit, is no different than a dope man who buys or sells weed or buys and sells dope and doesn't want to use his profit or use his product anymore because he understands he eats into his profit and he's trying to grow his business. And so, like I said, I don't know the value per se. But for anybody, just even understanding that they think that the streets are just like this deep, dark alley or this hugely or wildly different place, man. If you walk into corporate America in most places, man, you're basically, it's all the same. It's all the same behavior.
They're training grounds.
So I'll tell you this, while you all were talking, one thing I thought about, right? So, You look at what Sprint and T-Mobile just did. They didn't do nothing but do what basically co-ops do or do what gangs do or do it like. So here we go. I give you the same thing that Sprint and T-Mobile did is the same thing that dudes just around the neighborhood do, right? So dudes around the neighborhood where I grew up, they'd be like, okay, John, you buying 3 or 4 kilos. You know, I'm buying 3 or 4 kilos. Corey buying 3 or 4 kilos, right? Okay, so we all buying kilos, but we all paying, you know, $35,000 a piece, right? So we all put our money together and we go buy 12 together. You know, we get the product cheaper, we get it from one source, it gets better, and we can make sure that, you know, we form a relationship with each other. So if any of us runs out sooner than each other, we can grab dope from each other. This is real stuff that goes on in real neighborhoods, and this is how guys come together and eventually start like sort of like this group. This is the hood's investment group, right? It's just a different product, right? Sprint and T-Mobile didn't do nothing but the same thing, but just on a widely larger scale. They just said, hey, you know what I'm saying? You all control this much of the industry. We control this much of the industry. How about we hook up together and condense what we have? And I'm pretty sure that probably was a fucking year-long conversation.
Oh,
when you talk about that much money, you know what I'm saying? Probably could have been 2-3 years. Of conversation where you're talking about billions of dollars, $27 billion. But that's all they did. They got together and said, fuck it, we gonna just, you know, elbow fucking AT&T and what's the other player? Basically they said
Verizon.
Yeah, get the fuck out of here. You know, we about to just fucking try to monopolize as much as possible. But when you think about it, that's just gangster shit. You know what I'm saying? These same dudes.
Well, yeah. You could say it's gangster shit or it's just, or that is the entrepreneurialism that exists in the street. So you could go, it's one or the other, because if you here, look at the airline industry. I always talk about the airline industry and how much more we pay now and how there's more stops and the prices are higher. Well, what the fuck does everybody think happened? There's literally 5 airline groups now. There used to be 50 airlines that operated independently, and they said, if we come together, we don't have to get into price wars. Well, if we don't have to get into price wars, let's just up the price like a motherfucker, because you control all the routes to Cancun, right? You control all the routes to Mexico. You control all the routes to fucking Europe. Let's just get together and call ourselves a Star Alliance. That name sounds fucking good. And let's rape everybody's fucking ass and let's make plane tickets cost 3 times what they costed before. And you know what? Fuck direct flights. People can wait. We don't need to do that shit no more unless they're going to exactly where it benefits us. That's what happened to the airline industry. And right now, what's been going on for about, a year and a half is the SEC has been evaluating the merger between DirecTV and AT&T. And everyone is railing against it because they're like, listen, man, if AT&T and DirecTV merge, they're going to fucking own media. They're going to fucking own every from cable providing to internet. Like, nah, man, that's monopolization. But what they're doing is they're trying to sell off some assets so that can happen. But, you know, when you compare it to the streets, to go back to where we came from, it's like, I think there are some, let's call it non-thuggish things. I think when a group of guys get together, even if they are doing bad things, and they say, hey, let's form an alliance so we can get cheaper product. And you know what? It wouldn't hurt to get along either, right? Like these are things that benefit everybody. And I think that's what being an entrepreneur is about identifying.
But I think we're saying the same thing, and I didn't come home like that, or come to the point like that. Like, it's this, it's literally the same thing. And I think one of the biggest things that was just mind blowing to me, just the level of awareness that got me, was that I thought that not being in the streets and not being around that stuff, I thought that there would be a level of stress that I just would avoid, right? Or I thought like the stress that comes along with street stuff just doesn't exist in.
Well, you ain't got to worry about getting shot.
Well, I feel like this, you may not have to worry about getting shot, but a motherfucker will stab you in your back.
It's yes. The same thing, that's for fucking sure.
or if a motherfucker sees an opportunity and it can kill some business with you, but it benefits them personally, there's people who take advantage of that in a heartbeat, and it can hurt you and cripple you financially. And so, you may not get a bullet to the face or a bullet to the gut or a bat over the head, or you might not have somebody land in your bushes, but from a business standpoint.
But yeah, metaphorically, yeah, you still can, yeah, Reese.
And people will attack you. They attack you. And put like this, that's how it is. I can give you just a quick example. Like, I had what they call them foxes in the hen house, right? I've had people in my own business come and manipulate and steal and extract informations and get connections. The next thing you know, they bolting out the door. And they're doing the same thing that I taught them. You know what I'm saying? Now, in the streets, that's handled totally different than in the real world with consequences. But aside from the consequences, the behavior is just like dudes in the streets. You know what I'm saying? And so you think to yourself, like, man, you can't really be critical of guys in the streets because you do the same thing, or people who may be doing something that's deemed illegal. Like, the behavior for the most part is the same thing, just the consequences are a bit different. So that was just, you know, I was driving to school this morning, or driving my little girl to school, and that was one thing that really stuck out to me. But
you know what? Difficulty. I think we got to bring up difficulty, because I think the one thing that separates a legal business from legal business is it's hard to create a system that operates on every level that kicks out revenue and profits and scales. That's hard. That is hard. I don't want to say, you know, building an organization in the streets, whether it be small, whatever, isn't hard, but that's a lot easier, right? The supply and demand is understood. These are generations of people who probably unfortunately understand it, but it is hard to do something legally, pay your taxes, follow all these fucking rules, not swear at your employees and slap them around, right? Like, all those little things that you can't do in real business that you can do in street business are what make real business hard. And that's why discipline, I believe, ultimately separates the two.
Yeah, oh, I can give you that 100%, but then I'll get a little bit more specific. And with most street things, like, you know, so let's call it what it is. You're running a pharmacy of some sort. You know what I'm saying? And just imagine if CVS or Rite Aid or Kroger's or Walgreens was just open for business to anybody. They have a line from fucking here to Alabama everywhere. You know what I'm saying? And so there doesn't take a whole, put like just the physical craving for the things that they have, really dictate that space. You know what I'm saying? The drugs sell themselves inside those industries. You know what I'm saying? So as far as acquiring customers, you know, bringing onboarding people with HR, understanding, you know, how much it costs to get a customer, you know, building all of these other things, the discipline it takes. It's very much so complex, but there's a lot of inherent skill sets that you can come over and build off of. You know what I'm saying? I think that, like, you know, like, I'm just telling you, before I thought of the legal world, I just thought it was like just so foreign. And I didn't realize, just from messing around in the streets, that there were just so many built-in things normally that just had to have different words in the legal world. You know what I'm saying? Like, literally, yeah. I was just like, okay, these are the words in the legal world that match the behaviors and the things I'm doing, but this is something I can build off of. So I didn't even understand what an HR process was. I didn't understand that, you know, how much does it cost to bring on an employee? If you would have said that years ago, I'd be like, what the fuck are you talking about? You talk about when you pay taxes quarterly. I didn't even know what the fuck that was. You know what I'm saying? I didn't understand, like, you know, when we didn't have our insurance panel number the first year, just understand what a fucking K-1 was. You know what I'm saying? I had no clue of what these things were.
Different vocabulary, Reese.
Different vocabulary. But at the end of the day, like, I had a foundation, like, to even, just think about like this, to even say that you're doing something, to say that that skill set is transferable to the real world is that's empowering. Like, so Corey gave that lady's son a word, like, hey, your son's just not a fucking idiot, and he's not somebody who's just not interested in shit. The skill set that he has is entrepreneurial. So now forever, the mother can engage and talk to him as if he's an entrepreneur, or give him things that stimulate him, right? And so when I heard entrepreneur, yeah, and I understood what an entrepreneur was, I said, okay, people just like to buy and sell shit. You know, it doesn't matter what it is, but they like to just have their life in their own hands. And I'll say this until I die. I think the criminal spirit is entrepreneurial. You're taking your life in your own hands. Now, the mechanics of what you do and the things that you do to basically put yourself in a situation to, you know, to acquire money or resources, I get it. It's wrong, but in essence, it's the same thing. And so I just always believe in my head, like, you know, I know I'm like moving into a different direction now. I just always believe in my head that I think, like, the savior of most guys in either super rural places or super inner city places is entrepreneurship. You know what I'm saying?
And
understanding that, like, you know, there is possible for you to take your future in your own hands, either providing a product and providing a service. Like, I mean, just, it's kind of like scary to say it, but look at Corey and look at me. You know what I'm saying? Like, Corey, what saved your life? Entrepreneurship. Like, you know, fitness is a vehicle,
no
but
question.
In essence, you're an entrepreneur, right? And yep. I would guarantee you, take the color off of Corey, take the color off of me. He's not white. I'm not black. Nothing, right? If you just look at the mm-hmm. circumstances and just look at the upbringing, the poverty, the lack of resources, the lack of education, the lack of seeing success, the lack of people being around you, and the whole fight is like, how the fuck do I just get out of here? And that thing being like, I think there's so much that's built up inside of you. Just like, I got to get the fuck out of here. I got to get the fuck out of here. So, you know, his vehicle was the coal mine.
All I could ever think about.
It, like this, but yours is coal mines because that's what's around you. And yours is fitness because that's what you want to do. The only vehicle mm-hmm. I see to get out, to get to like the fucking like level ground is football. So, okay, football got me to this level ground. Fitness and coal mining got you there. But the spirit was the self-motivating, the self-encouragement, the fucking do for self, to let me, I don't want to be around here. That's entrepreneurship. I don't give a fuck who you are. Like, that's I don't give a fuck if you white, black, from fucking Tanzania, or from fucking Little Italy. It doesn't matter. That spirit, right?
Urban, suburban.
Urban, suburban doesn't matter. You know what I'm saying? And I guess that's what I'm saying. But like even to talk about it is so encouraging, and I feel empowered to talk about it, because you can really speak life into people and say, oh, my man, look, you know, like this is not it. And I'm just having a perspective, like, because when you see, like, kids in the hopelessness, or people just thinking, like, yo, this is it. I'm going to just grow up in this shit. This is where it's at. Like, this is it. No, that's not it. Like, this is just, like, this is where you're at right now, but this doesn't have to be it. So me having this conversation is a little bit personal and emotional based on the people we deal with. And understanding that there's talented people that, if taught the right way, or if the language is
exposed to the right stuff,
then, oh, I can build a business. Like, Johnny, this shit I learned from you, or shit I learned from Corey. I can remember and I know I'm ranting right now. I don't want to take up the whole time, but I can remember when I first came back to Ohio and Corey was with, the other company. And as he's talking about business, these were words I never heard before. You know what I'm saying? He's just talking about what's going on. I never heard this stuff before. And just, you know, just think about how many people can unlock their lives just from hearing information being delivered to them. So that's all I have to say.
That, I'll let y'all that financial IQ stuff, Reese, was part of like this whole strategy for me. When I always talk about this, like changing generations, when you talk about hearing about K-1s, quarterly taxes, profit margin, like those type, that using that vocabulary is how, you know, wealthy people talk. And that's something that I didn't have around me as a kid. And that's what I try to pride myself on, that at 11, 10, 11, 12 years old, Alex would hit me with, well, what's your margin on that product, Dad? How, you know, he would understand, like he understands the sneaker business right now. Dad, I can get on this thing and I can flip it and make $100 on StockX. Like that basic mentality and understanding of how you can make a dollar from a product creator, or us going through that process, going to get a logo made for him, going to Alibaba to source yo-yos this one time for the school project. Like he laid it down to his teacher. His teacher hadn't even known how to do some of that stuff. Like, and that to me, that vocabulary, that education, that self-taught things that I've learned from John, I've learned from you, I've learned from everybody included I've been around, it is like all of it wrapped up together is how I was trying to like package this thing for the next generation. And even teaching, you know, some of the older people in my family that reach back out to me. And so I think those things are huge, and people that aren't exposed to them. Like when I'm around my area, right, there's some depressed areas very close to where I live. And I see some of the people ripping and rolling around. And I'm just like, I see their kids and I see how, like how much poverty there is. And I'm just thinking, these guys got no shot, man, unless somebody exposes them to things like this or a different way of thinking, because there is going to be that very small percentage that's going to search it out, or it's going to be inspired. Like I was inspired by the 90s rappers. I always come back to it. They inspired me to be like, cause they was always talking about the come up. Pac and Biggie always talked about the come up. That's all they talked about. And so to me, but they were, and then we were talking about real situations that was happening in their area. And so to me, it was like, that's why I was so motivated by the music. I was like, man, fuck this trailer. Like I'm trying to get out of here. I'm trying to then take, you know, anybody from my area that they can look up to me and say, this guy did it, blah, blah, blah. This is the way he operates. This is the discipline that he's showing. This is the words that he's using. Like that's the kind of things when I see these people and I'm like, they either, there's going to be that 1%, they're going to look for it, but they got to be exposed to it. That's why I'm so passionate about doing the things we do here, because it only takes that one thing that can then change how, you know, somebody operates moving forward from here on out. And so I think that the street mentality or the corporate mentality, it, all of it kind of is intermingled. It's just that, just being aggressive in what you want for yourself and understanding that there's something else out there and that you can do it legitimate. Yeah. 8 years legitimate, Maurice. It's good work.
And man, understanding that people are going to let you down. Like, okay, so in the business world, the more people control, whether it be at a CEO position or a fucking pastor of a fucking big church or whatever it may be, like the more difficult they are to deal with. And it's unfortunate because all they're doing is they're leveraging their power to get the most out of you. And maybe I shouldn't have used the word unfortunate, because can you blame them for it? And in business, I'll say, no, you can't blame them for it, because actually if you work your way up and you leverage everything you have and are like, listen, I control this empire. If you want to get in and sell me something, or if you want a piece of it, you got to fucking pay the motherfucking piper, because I took 20 years to get there. Like I remember the first time I encountered that, I thought these people, see, this is an important point. I thought they were being unfair to me. What I want people to understand is in business, there is no fair and unfair. There are the people who make the fucking rules and the people who got to follow the rules. And depending on what position you're in, you're one of those two people, right? 100%. So it, you know, when you're making the ask, you're a follower. right? When you're being asked, you make the fucking rules. And I got nailed so hard by that at the beginning, but then I realized I'm going to be in a position one day. And obviously, I'm trying to grow every day from a business standpoint. But when I get there, I'm going to operate similarly because leverage is everything in business. But I'm going to try to do it with some humility and with some respect and not just step on motherfuckers' throats because I can, right? Because that's a bully. That's a bully. But you can leverage your position with a little bit of humility and understanding. And you can guide people to say, hey, next time you come to me with this shit, here's how you got to come to me, right? Here's the deal, because there's 4,000 other motherfuckers who want a piece of this pie, right? So if you're going to come to me because I like you, because I care about you, or just because I want you to develop and maybe you will go do this with someone else in my position, you want to do it like this, right? So that was a very important lesson in my career, is that these people who sit atop these thrones, you can't be coming with some fucking straight up shit. You got to pay the piper, and you have to, here's the thing. You have to do it in a way where you're not saying to them, I'm paying the piper. Because if you say I'm paying the piper, it's like, get the fuck out of here. You think you can buy me? You think you can, you know what I'm saying? But at the same time, that's what they all want. So you have to learn the game of nuance. It's all about the game of nuance. Like, oh, I see you're doing this. I got a guy who does that too. I should connect you because he could probably help you build this. You know, okay, on to our conversation. You know, that's how you do it. You don't just say it. So these are really intricate lessons learned, but nuance is very important in speaking to people that are far above you that you aspire to work with.
Hey, my grandpa said straight up, he told me, like, when I was in eighth grade or seventh grade, when I was like trying to talk about, yeah, you know, I'm interested in this or that. He said, let me tell you, I was on this bank. He was on this board of directors for this bank, and they was about to get bought out, and he only had X amount of shares, and these other guys, they was bigger players, and he didn't want to do it, but they did it, blah, 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 whatever. He just said, here's the deal. In business, the guy with the gold makes all the rules. And that's just the fucking truth.
Yeah.
He said, and you want to be the guy with the gold in your situation. The dude who got the most money and got the most business, he fucking calls the shots. And right. That's just it. Right. Same shit you just said, Johnny. He said, the sooner you realize that and the sooner you become that person, the more pop leverage and an opportunity. Like, he's just like, that's just it.
Don't you're going to follow it. The rules. Don't fight it.
You're just going to follow the rules until you're the guy making them.
Right.
And that's never been realer. That has never left me since he said that to me. Yeah. And it is the fucking truth.
Yeah. You don't want to deal with it. Like, everyone who does it. Oh, you don't want to deal with it. You think to yourself, this is bullshit. I don't want to deal with it. Okay. Well, then work hard enough to get yourself in a position where you are that person. That is the only answer to combating that frustration.
Well, I'll say this, Johnny. The irony is that I had that conversation. And I can tell I had a 51-minute conversation with an individual, which is entirely not normal for me to talk to somebody on the phone for 51 minutes, but this conversation was important. And it was my guy who got out of prison, right? And so I don't believe that money is the most important thing that you can give to a person. I think information is. I think, like, information is everything. Mm-hmm. But I think we probably spent 25 minutes talking about that thing, and I was talking to him. I said, hey man, I said, one of the biggest things that I see is that, like you say, like, situations happen where a person just doesn't respect or like the dynamic of the relationship that they're in with the person who's in charge of them, or who has a person who's a gatekeeper to other opportunity, and the lack of commitment inside those spaces, or a lack of humility inside those spaces. I've seen many guys crap out, you know, just from not wanting to be humble. I also think that, and I'll switch gears for a minute. I think that we deal with a generation of people, and I don't care how old you are. I just think it's just so much within the generation. You just don't, the commitment is not here. Commitment is not like a big thing in a society. Like, everybody dances around from one thing to another, and just the basic commitment, whether it's, you know, be it with women, be it with occupations, be it with you know, friends, be it with, you know, fucking look at basketball teams, football teams, everything in our society preaches like, you know, if you don't like it, just go somewhere else and do something else. And I think that that mentality subconsciously fucks people over in business because, you know, we don't give people a chance to develop, or you don't give yourself a chance to develop inside of an incubator and become who you're supposed to become inside of what industry. And I'll tell you, in general, I was telling him, I said, hey, man, you know, how about you get in, learn what the hell's going on inside this certain industry, you know, learn for the first 120 days before you make your move. And when I told him about 120 days, that shit seemed like a fucking decade to him. You know what I'm saying? And I said, nah, you got to learn. And then once you learn what's going on and how stuff laid, then you can make a move and, you know, ultimately find out where you want to be. But I think that, you know, just a lack of commitment in society, you know, and I don't know if you all see it, you know, just with.
And patience.
Yeah. If fucking patience and commitment go hand in hand. Like when you committed to something, you fucking got to be patient just within the process to just start to unfold or let the process reveal what it's going to reveal to you. You know, I don't know how other to say it than, you know, just people aren't patient and people aren't committed. You know what I'm saying? And like, I guess I was going to push the conversation to you all to see if it sparked any thought, you know, and I know like, you know, we were all supposed to say something. So I didn't want this whole thing to be about what I brought up. So I was just trying to push the conversation onto you two and give you all feedback on whatever it is that you were going to bring to the table.
It's halftime, Johnny. You know, I'm balling out here in the streets.
Corey, I've been hitting them with the music. Like when you entered in, you were humming. Like, were you trying to make up like your own beat? What was it?
I was beatboxing, John. I was thinking in my mind. Like, I was, hey, listen, dude. I was AI. Like, right, check it out. I was AI in my head, right? I was crossing people over. Oh, I had this beat going on. I said, it's halftime. I'm throwing the ball to you. I'm saying, John, get off the bench. Come out here in the ball court.
Get off the bench. You're talking to James Harden, son. You're talking to James Harden. I'll cross you over. I'll look at you, and I'll drop a three. I'll turn my back, and I'll be back on defense, dude. What are you talking about?
Oh, I couldn't wait to say that. So anyway, John. MaxEverMuscle.com. So, you know, the podcast really was built during the process of creating the brand, the band. It is a band. Creating the brand, challenging ourselves to do things a different way from the way it's delivered.
You do play instrument. You play the fiddle. You play the flute. So you're
motherfucker. I already know where you're going with that. So once again, you're the flute player. All right. So I got the mic now. I'm going to use it. All right. So MaxEverMuscle.com, a couple things that stick out. One, it comes to your house in a potato sack, AKA burlap sack. What's in your sacks? The hashtag never happened before. Everybody digs it. Even though they see the sack on the internet or, you know, on Instagram, they still believe it comes in a box. It does not. It comes to your house in a sack. Two, another thing that's hugely different than everyone else. Any product can be intermixed in the stack. When you build a stack, any three, meaning
is intermixed an actual combination of words? Is that like appropriate when it comes to intermixed? Can we get someone to look that up? Intermingled, maybe?
Intermingled or intermixed. I don't know. Okay. We'll come back to you on that. All right. You're challenging Appalachian. You're challenging my Appalachian dialect here.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
So you intermix, you intermix any three products, whether you need a pre-workout, post-workout protein, and we throw in a free t-shirt for $100, or you intermix any five. And so the key is that when you go to the website, it's not that one's this price, one's that price. All the retail is $34.99. Very easy process. Really challenge ourselves to have something unique like that. So it makes the buying process, you know, pretty simple, John. Give me a couple of your kind of takes part of that.
I mean, think about that, because sports nutrition, supplements, whatever you want to refer to it as, they aren't one-time purchases, right? These are things that as people who are committed to health and fitness, they're constants. So you need your protein, right? You need your aminos. A lot of people need their pre-workout or whatever it is that they take. These are things that are absolute constants. And because of that, because we knew our customers would be coming back on a monthly basis, we said, how can we make this as easy as possible for them? And as opposed to having $60 proteins and $35 test boosters, or no, we said everything is $35. And if people want to combine three products, man, let's just make it 100 and let's hook them up with a free jersey, right? Which is our team. It's not a jersey. It's a max effort muscle shirt. And there's about a million to choose from. If you want to buy five, we'll make it even easier, right? Because you need your aminos, you need your pro, you need all this stuff, right? It's 160. So all these other companies are trying to make up stupid names, Hydro 24Z89, you know, and then they charge you like $79. Here's how it is at Max Effort, dude. Every product's $35. You combine it, you get swag. So we have made the supplement buying process so much easier. And we've created a sports nutrition brand. And that's why I think we've gotten about 400 emails this morning about people who want to be ambassadors for our company.
Yeah, and by the way, we actually work out and live the life too, motherfuckers. I'm gonna end with that.
Franco Colombo, man. Or Colombo.
John, tell them about podcast influencer, then we'll let them go.
Absolutely. So as we developed this podcast, we realized, yeah, you have to be consistent. You have to deliver content to your subscribers and to your listeners on a consistent basis. You cannot miss. But beyond that, just like any other product in the world that you want to get out there, you have to have a marketing strategy. You have to market the product so it can get more shine. And when it gets more shine, more people can listen. And when more people listen, you get a bigger subscriber base. When you get a bigger subscriber base, you're more influential. When you're more influential, you can get bigger guests. When you get bigger guests, you can sell bigger products and get bigger sponsorships. At Podcast Influencer, we literally, no BS, have a first to market product when it comes to marketing your podcast and getting it seen. That is the most effective way to market a podcast in the world. That is on my name. And we can also help you in the consulting process. We can also help you ideate. We can also help you produce your show, because we made a lot of fucking mistakes producing this one. But we learn from them like we always do. So check it out and contact us. Feel free to reach out, podcastinfluencer.com.
All right, Johnny, the freestyle episode is killing it. Let's get back to the show. I have one thing, Johnny. I was listening to some Gary Player. For you guys that don't know, Gary Player is one of the best golfers in the history. He's from South Africa. He talked a lot about patience. This motherfucker said he would get, because, you know, in golf especially, you know, he's a multi-champion on the, you know, all the majors, the whole nine. He's one of the only people to win the Grand Slam as a regular player in the PGA and as the Master. He won all four in both. And he said he would get behind the slowest person on the highway on purpose and test his patience and challenge himself to go on something he wasn't rushed from a trip standpoint. Let's say, you know, he didn't have to be there at a certain time, but he was heading somewhere. He would find the slowest person and challenge himself to stay calm, just like in a big golf tournament, if he was like stuff was going on. So I just thought that was interesting that he would challenge his patience. Cause look, who wants to stay behind the slow person? I fucking never want to. I'm looking at, is there a double yellow line? Is there even on a single lane road? How do I get around? But he would, very interesting. He doesn't have a lot of content out there because he's like 80 years old. But on YouTube, there's a few people that have interviewed him. And I read his book called Don't Choke by Gary Player, which is pretty cool. And it talks about business and golf and everything. And I've been down the rabbit hole of some of his content. But I thought testing your patience on purpose was an interesting kind of thing. So I just want to mention that. Go ahead, John.
No, I just think, yeah, I mean, that's a great point. That's going to develop. number one, being present, and number two, a lot of patience, which you need in golf. But kind of to what Mo was saying is, you know, when you're talking about commitment and loyalty, I think this day and age and patience, it's like, man, I almost feel like, what should we expect, right? Like, what should we expect? Because as a society, what can't you get on demand? Hey, if I want food delivered to my door, if I want a prime rib delivered to my door in 30 minutes on demand, right? Right. Like if I want to watch a TV show that aired 8 months ago, 10 seconds on demand, if I want new fucking friends, I can go to Facebook and make a new friend in Mumbai, India on demand. Like, I can get anything I want within a matter of under an hour or and sometimes much less. So when we live in a world that's operated by our phone and everything that kind of, I don't want to say matters in life, but everything that plays a part in our daily life, we can get in a minute, like on demand. Like, man, patience is going to corrode. Patience is going to corrode. And I want every listener to look at it like this, like, okay, if that's what's going to happen, I got a huge competitive advantage if I practice patience, because all these other motherfuckers are sitting there on their cell phones, pop, 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 pop. I haven't gotten what I wanted out of this job in 2 months. I'm out. I deserve more. I'm going to go be a CEO here. You know, everyone's just jumping around. If you got that patience, like I always say in sales, like I still make sales calls, not because I have to, because I fucking love it and I'm really fucking good at it, right? Like I fucking love it. Now, most people fucking hate it, but I've always said this to everybody. If you commit, like sales is a place where you can make so much money, because once you learn the art of it, you can apply it to any field. You can sell anything. It is an art. So if you're willing to do the two-year rule, which is I'm going to eat shit, expect nothing for 2 years and fucking 12 hours a day, right? I'm going to sacrifice 2 years of my life and eat shit for fucking 12 hours a day. You're going to be a millionaire. I promise you. 2 years. So, in the scheme of things, if we all live till we're 80, if someone told you sacrifice 2 years of your life to be a millionaire, literally a millionaire, how many of you would say, yeah, everyone would raise their motherfucking hand, right? But on that second day of calling people for fucking 12 hours, I guarantee you 95% of the people would walk out the fucking door.
But John, people are going to happy hour. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what happens on the second day.
Motherfucker, I don't go to happy hour. I go to happy, dial that motherfucking phone up, and let's make some more money. Like, that's the difference. That's the difference. Let them go to happy hour. Let them waste their $2,200 check that they should have put towards rent. And then they need to recruit a third roommate on fucking off and playing on the jukebox and fucking whacking their fucking pud when they could be fucking getting shit done and setting up the rest of the people. Don't take life serious enough. Like, I'm here. Here's what I'm going to do. And I've said this since I'm 21. I'm going to bust my motherfucking ass for 20 years nonstop. But after 20 years, bro, like, hey, I'm pulling back, because those 20 years, 21 to 41, that's when you have your energy. That's when you have everything. That's when you can go fucking crush it. And I'm not saying you can't crush it afterwards, but I'm going to take that 20-year period and slaughter it. I'm going to sacrifice everything. And you know what? I am going to bet on myself and say, once I hit that age, I can do whatever the fuck I want. And guess what? I hit that earlier. I hit that earlier than 41.
I tell you to build.
I love that.
I tell you to build off of that. I said something similar to myself, that I'm going to bust my ass literally to get to a point in my life. I always say, everybody knows my ultimate end play is real estate. You know, my ultimate end goal is to take care of myself. But that's my deal. You know, bust my ass for the next 10 years, like literally for 10 years. And I don't want to say my life is on cruise control, but take another step into whatever it is I want to do next. You know, maybe all this working hard will allow me to work smarter and I'll have more resources to do so. But, you know, I hear you definitely on that. But then, Corey, I got to add on to what you were talking about with patience. I tell you that my patience was developed. I wasn't able to drive behind somebody in a car, but my patience definitely got developed when I was incarcerated. My first 7 months, I was locked down for 23 hours out the day. So that built an enormous amount of patience in me. And one, I can say I attribute that patience to the shit that I go through now. And if shit isn't going my way, or how I like it, I always, when shit isn't going my way or how I don't like it, I always attribute that to me not understanding the circumstances or me needing to learn something. I don't never believe that you get stuck and confused and frustrated, you know, when your mind is clear and you understand all of what's going on. I think that's like where the frustration comes from when people get lost in traffic or they lost on the street or they don't know what the hell is going on. But I think that same thing like crosses over into business or into just, you know, into just development in general. You become frustrated, you start to complain when you don't know. So usually those senses of me being impatient, I always look at that like as a purpose or a point to self-discover and figure out like, why the fuck am I impatient or what's going on that makes me have this feeling. And usually when I can figure that feeling out and master that feeling, you know, I usually get ahead or move forward. And hopefully that makes some sort of fucking sense.
Hey, I think it makes a lot of sense, Reese. There's a thing that John brought up earlier I kind of want to swing back to that was talking about, and it has street, you know, kind of street implications too and in business about being feared or loved, right? And that there's people that do it both ways. Like, I'm pretty sure, I mean, I've had some people scared of me in the past, but for the most part, I'm not really a feared guy that I'm aware of. But however, you two guys have personalities that in your past, I think have been feared at times. So I think you guys could both speak to, you know, having that potential way that you did it maybe in your younger life compared to how I both know you do it now. And I think that's an interesting topic just because there is truly two ways. And you see the way that it's depicted, whether it's the mob boss or the big CEO. And I just think that's you almost have to take one or two paths essentially. So I think there's some very cool kind of takeaways there, guys.
I'll say one thing to it. Like what I've learned is, yeah, fear loved it is the statement we've all heard. I have learned that fuck being feared, but commanding respect just by being in a room, just by having a presence, to me, is very effective. Because when you command respect by simply being in the room with people, that means people in that room, they know who you are, they know what you're capable of, they know what you do, and more than anything, they know how committed you are to your craft. So that commands respect.
Well said.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Well said, Johnny.
I don't believe in the fear part because I learned not to believe in it. Now, to be loved is great. I think the best combination would be to be loved and to inspire, but you have to command respect. As a leader, you have to command respect. So I think if just breaking myself down, I can command respect. I'm getting better at inspiring, but I've spent so much time on you will respect me. And I'm trying to lighten that up to a point where, like, I want people to respect me because of what I've done, not because I power it onto them. So that's a work in progress for sure.
Yeah. So is it fear? So it's more like rather than fear or love, it's like respect, inspire. That is like the respect and the inspiration is how the love comes. And it's like that just happens through your actions, not because, like you said, you force it on somebody, Johnny.
Yeah. And I think it's important to be like people got to know, right? Like people got to know they can't say some stupid shit to me, like, period. They got to know that.
I think they know that.
Right. No, no. Yeah, exactly.
So, but I agree.
Yeah. I think it's important because ultimately I can hold, you know, your job. I can help you grow. I can spend time with you. But just listen, I don't say stupid shit to you. Right. So like a lot of younger kids who are coming up, they think, oh, just because he smiled at me or he got along with me, I can go and, you know, ask him about, you know, his personal life and doing this and doing that. Well, maybe not. There's a time and a place. But yeah, combining that demanding respect by simply having a presence and inspiring, right? That's the second part. I think inspiring is probably more important, but that's the perfect combo.
Mine is similar, different. I don't even know how you call it. But I don't think I go in thinking either. Like I either got to be, you know, love or respected. When I'm going into something, I'm doing dealings with somebody, I just like to always say just, you know, just own a certain space within the conversation. And usually, you know, I only take meetings or I'm trying to do something about stuff that I know. So one way I guess I get out of both, you know, love and fear is just kind of articulating myself with the stuff that I know. So it's not either a love or a fear. It is a respect conversation or it's a respect dynamic because they say, okay, you know, regardless of how many I felt about him, what I thought about him, the stuff that he's talking about, you know, he's very in tune to, or he's an intellectual about it. And there's a sense of humility. So I think I kind of like stay in like a different space, and I'm not even sure what it's called. But I definitely, I always talk about the Suge Knight effect on people. And I told, you know, I told you all before, and I think I might have said it in a few podcasts before, that I kind of seen how the world treated Suge Knight when Suge Knight came and he was coming with the shoves and the pushes and basically, you know, I kick your ass and you come and you be a bully. You don't nobody want to do business with anybody like that. And before you know it, your ass will be kicked out of business. And so I try to stay away from that stuff as much as possible. Make sure that, you know, I'm just articulating myself and letting it be about the business rather than, you know, I want to intimidate you. But then love is even a scary thing because this is just my personal experience. I can't say anything. I got this feeling that, you know, people in business, you know, in business in general, people tend to love you as long as you're doing for them or as long as you're, you know, providing some opportunity or making their ideas become the main thing. Or if you're letting right. them be in charge or if they can make the money and the margins that they want to, or if they can hook the friends up with different opportunity and employment and stuff like that. And so, you know, early on, I got jaded, you know, from feeling like I was loved by people. And things were jaded because it was the selfishness of people around me. And then when things, the dynamic of things changed and, you know, we wouldn't let people have their way, then there wasn't love. You know what I'm saying? So I just rather keep things in the respect space, you know what I'm saying? Respect what you do, let people bring what they bring to the table and make sure I articulate myself and what it is that I'm doing. But I try to stay away from the super love or super friend space. And I definitely want to stay out of the fear space. I think it comes down, I just want to be respected for what I know and what I do and just try to stay out of all the other stuff because I think it can get muddy if, you know, if the people who are claiming to love you, they don't get their way and a lot of how they treat you is rooted in, you know, what you do for them.
Yeah. I mean, love is dangerous. And that's why I think to be loved or to be feared should be changed to be respected and to inspire. Right. Because yeah, love is so dangerous. And I can speak for myself, Mo, like what you said when you thought that, you know, there was love and then people turn, like that was my naivete in business early on. Like I thought, oh, somebody loves me. So not loves me, but like somebody loves what I'm doing or what we're doing together. So they would never. No. They always will. If there's something to gain in business, you know, that's why coming up in business, you learn so much. You have to eliminate the naivete and to say, this person who I'm getting along with so great, who I'm developing right now, if they get an opportunity to better their family, to better their life, that crosses paths and crosses with what I have groomed them to do, I'd love to think that they wouldn't take it. I'd love to think that, but odds are they will.
They will.
So that's why business has a harsh reality. That's why I agree. You can't mix love in there. It's like you want to inspire as a leader and you have to be respected or else people won't listen to you. But yeah, the feared love thing, I think it is a little bit outdated.
I think it's also just like most everything else, right? It's hanging in the middle. Whether it's fear or love, let's say that that's still the topic. The middle is respect, that you're not feared and you're maybe not loved. People just are in the middle about you and they respect what you do. And at the end of the day, it's like anything that we're talking about, like being high or being too low or one way or the other, usually doesn't work out for you. You got to run down the middle because that's the steady. Right. I mean, that's it.
Yeah. I mean, we're coaches, right? In business, you know, we use sports analogies all the time. As leaders, we're coaches, right? And everybody can look at their favorite coach in any sport, and they could look at horrible coaches in any sport and just think about them in your head. Just think about that coach, whoever pops in your mind, and think about their approach or their perceived approach to their players and why it works. And then think about their perceived approach, the failing coaches, to their players and why it doesn't work. And that is literally the same as being a leader in a business. You have to deal with personalities, you have to deal with egos, and then you have to bring it all together to say, guys, we're unified for a common cause. So I think for people to understand kind of what we're trying to get at, just think of a very successful coach and a very unsuccessful coach, and that'll probably clear a lot of things up in the listener's mind.
But I wanted to give some advice, and maybe it's for either business owners or people in charge of something. You know, one way you can save yourself, and I've learned this just from dealing with people or just dealing within the business, in the first process to stay out of the emotional space and to stay out of the, you know, super I love you space or the super fearful space. And one thing that we can all be measured on is just to outline expectations amongst each other, you know, when dealing with people. And I think that just understanding how to outline expectations and the dynamic of the relationship, you know, I think that that stays away from, you know, I love you, and you don't have to necessarily get into, you know, all these conversations with, you know, super I help friends and all that stuff. And keep everything about the business as much as possible. You know, if you own your own business and you're listening to this, you know, keep everything about performance, keep everything about the business, and don't get smoothed up going to happy hour with your friends, you know, and don't expect, you know, too many personal favors or you know, don't get into that muddy relationship where, you know, you start to give and get too many favors from one another, because then that just kind of blurs lines and convolutes lines. And the next thing you know, when something isn't going as planned, you know, somebody's mad, you know what I mean? And, I'll say this too, you know, it sounds crazy because I believe friendship and business can exist and does mix if done right. But really, like, really you have to protect yourself. And more times than not, it just, in my experience of mixing too much personal, too much business, things can get muddy. But just make sure expectations on what people should be doing and how they should be performing, just make sure that that's the number one thing, because, you know, business has to be first when you're doing business with people. When you begin to put all the friendship stuff first and all the I love yous first and then ask for favors, or yeah, if somebody's doing that, then things become like super left field, and, you know, everything that you work for, to work to get, you know, can just kind of crash overnight.
I couldn't agree with that anymore. Well, like, if I was to say, like, one thing you build a business relationship on with anybody, like the most important thing, I could take this back to when me and Corey formed, when me and my other partners formed, when I managed athletes, it's setting up the expectation from both sides at the beginning. Having a clear understanding, and here's what I would piggyback on it, is get what I like to call the hard, ugly shit out of the way at the beginning of a business relationship. And that hard, ugly shit could be setting up expectations, because sometimes it's uncomfortable to talk about, talking about money, talking about the structure of how someone's going to be compensated, talking about the structure of how a business is going to be governed, talk about the structure of the position of a job, like get the hard shit out of the way at the beginning. Because once both sides clearly understand each one's expectation, I'm telling you, that is how you will have a smooth business relationship that is focused on business.
But let me tell you, I'll dig into that a little bit further, John. The hardest conversation you have to have that people tend to avoid when having all these meetings are how people are paid. Like, you have to have those conversations.
Right.
And you have to outline them. Like, I think one of the worst things that you can do is to start to build business and not have a conversation on how people plan to get paid once things are rolling. And I know, you know, that's kind of like don't put the cart before the horse sort of deal. But if you don't have that and things begin to roll, and I think like on paper, people need to outline and define what it is that they do and what they bring to the table and what value that they bring to whatever venture you're going through. I think like if you don't outline that, I think you're also setting yourself up for failure if something then turns out to be successful. Because I think so many people, they get crippled in that stage. And I think if that's ironed out, I think that everything else runs smooth from there. So you want your business to start from a solid platform and let everything flow downhill from there. And as things come up, you say, hey, at least we've built a solid foundation. And my favorite line of this all is like, please don't count other people's money. You know what I'm saying? I had to throw that in there because I think that that's, you know, as gravely important as well. You know, please just worry about your value. Worry about what you bring to the table. Stay out of the spaces of counting other people's finances. Realize that, you know, like, you know, who you may feel that you are is one thing, but what you bring to a business and the value that you bring to a business is one thing. Like, you can think you're, you know, I may think I'm cooler than John. John may think he's cooler than me, but if me and John are going out and selling pillows and John has more value in selling pillows than I do, but I think I'm cooler and I think just because of who I am, I deserve a 50-50 split. So, hey, you know, we don't bring the same value to this thing, so we can't have a 50-50 split. Learning to separate who you are and how you feel about yourself and what you bring to a business. If you don't outline that stuff at the top of a business, I can almost guarantee that you'll basically run into a situation where it will get very muddy.
You and John are going against each other in pillow sales. And Maurice's tagline is cool as the other side of the pillow. All right. So I think a couple of quick takeaways. One, John, I like that point of setting expectation. I remember that was like one of my things I was the most worried about whenever we, you know, formed the partnership of coming off the last business, things I knew that I wanted for my family different than the last 8 years, being able to be upfront with you on a lot of that stuff. And you were trying to set your expectations, for me too. So I thought that was like really productive. And probably the true way that we were even be able to become partners.
Totally.
I mean, totally. If we wouldn't have had that conversation and it wouldn't have been agreed upon, I don't think this would have worked near as well as it has. And we're essentially about to go through a mini version of that again as you move here.
Yeah, without a doubt. And I know, I mean, that's a great point, Corey. I want to just crystallize something on that point in mm-hmm. people's memories. So when I would talk to fighters that I would manage and right before I would sign them, I'd say this to them, and no one else would say this to them, but I would say this to them. I'd say, you contacted me or I contacted you because A, I want to make money on you, or B, you think I can make more money for you, right? Like, that's why we are, let's cut through all the shit. We're not best friends. Like, we're not homeboys. We're not this, we're not that. If that develops, it's a bonus. But you think I can make you more money. I think you can make me money. So we're going to have this relationship based on that. We're not going to have this relationship based on John carrying your bag to weigh-ins and being your buddy fight week, going to breakfast with you, doing all this shit. I'm here to make you money and you are here to make me money. Do we understand each other? And they were like, what the fuck? Yeah, cool, let's do it. Like they, like as an athlete, They were like, no one talks like that. They say family. Oh, we're family. Oh, we're homeboy. No, that's all bullshit. That's all bullshit until no one's earning, dude.
Yeah.
So the straight talk, Mo knows as an athlete. Like, yeah. That was my approach.
Absolutely. You know what? Now I see why you were successful doing it, because you know what? In the back of an athlete's mind, that's all he's thinking about. I'm coming to you for money.
Right.
Coming to you for money. If we cut to the chase and just say, we just trying to make each other money. Now we're starting from a real place. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like nothing
right.
real can be threatened. You know what I'm saying? That's it. Yeah. And you build from there. So I feel like this, I don't know a whole lot, but I can tell you this, if you all rewind and just hear some of the stuff that was said here now, like even some of the stuff that we talked about, you know, towards the end of the stuff, you know, you probably can't make a cool YouTube video out of it. You probably won't have a Lamborghini in the back. You probably won't have a 20,000 square foot rented home in the background. You know what I'm saying? It probably won't be like some secret link to click to this, you know, crazy seminar. But I guarantee you the information is worth its weight in gold, because these are the conversations or the things that, you know, have caused me anxiety and stress and it pissed me off. But these are the things that you just don't know. You can't pick this shit up in a book. You know what I'm saying? You can't read about it. These are things that these are actual experiences. Everything I just named to everybody on this podcast from the beginning of me taking my daughter to school and talking about the streets mimicking this stuff into just the stuff that we're talking about, but patience being developed and just actual business at the end. Like it's just stuff that if you're an entrepreneur trying to build your business, you're going to go through. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, to have sort of like a guide or to have like some sort of awareness, because that's ultimately what it is. I have some awareness and I haven't been through this. You know, that's all practice is. You know, and I don't want to be long-winded, but you go through practice at football practice and they simulate what's about to come up against you during the whole game. So when you get in the game, you can say, okay, I've seen this before and I can make the appropriate move based upon how I prepared myself. And these podcasts are nothing different, right? Giving information. So when you come inside of a circumstance, you say, okay, I may have not been here, but this looks very familiar. And, you know, John said this, Corey said this, Maurice said this. And so based upon who you are, you can choose a path. And so the ultimate goal is to unlock and get to where you're trying to get a little bit faster based upon having information. That's all it is.
Amen to that.
True. I think that wraps it up good. Listen, great stuff today, guys. I like how sometimes we don't have really a clue what we're going to talk about, and it ends up being so fucking good, man. So good. Like somebody left a comment. They tagged us on Instagram about how, you know, they've been listening to the podcast. And I saw it towards the bottom. He goes, this stuff's so real. And just like a disclaimer, like the language sometimes gets a little tough. But that's when I know it's even more real life situations, because they feel so passionate about it. It's like stuff they actually went through or experienced or learned. And it's like, you know, he actually complimented that he knows we're not just saying certain things to sound cool, that it's real emotion and hardship. And that's what we do at Business and Biceps. And that's why when we're in person, then we have video, you can see expressions. You're going to be able to see the, you know, as we decorate the recording studio and have our own pieces of things out there. There's just so much more to come. And I'm pumped to kind of go on this, kind of, you know, just this rocket ship of Business and Biceps with you two guys. I think it's going to be. It's next level shit. I mean, straight talk, which is good. So, all right, make sure you guys, obviously, if you need any supplements, go to maxeffortmuscle.com. If you, for any of your supplement needs, if you buy any three of the supplements in a free t-shirt for $100, any five supplements in a free t-shirt for $150, it's never been done like this before, everybody. This is a business. This is a biceps. This is everything. Like, this is a part of the business.
This is a biceps. That's my favorite line of the show. This is a biceps.
This is a bicep, John Fosco. And so here's the deal. Like, we built the podcast early on around Max Effort Muscle. We talk about it. We use it a lot as examples, but we challenged ourselves to do a new type of thing. And no one has done a system like this where you can interchange the SKUs like that. So check out maxeffortmuscle.com for all your supplement needs. Johnny, tell them about Podcast Influencer.
We all need to market our podcast, guys. Like, no one's just going to like magically find it. There'll be a handful of people, but ultimately everybody who you see on the top of the charts are killing it on the audio front, and they're pumping big money into their podcast for it to rank highly and for it to be heard. And Podcast Influencer has a first to market product to market your podcast so you can be heard, so you can find out if you have what it takes to be a player in the podcast world. And we also help with consulting, ideation, production, all that stuff in the podcast world. So podcasting's exploding. So is Podcast Influencer. So I recommend you visit us at podcastinfluencer.com and get some more information, because we can, I'll say it again, we can help you.
And lastly, give us a 5-star rating on iTunes, only a positive comment. Reach out, you know, tag us on social media, biz, buys, you know, make sure
subscribe.
That you subscribe to the channel. You have to subscribe. Don't just listen, subscribe.
And I want to say one thing on that. Okay, guys, I'm guilty of this. So when you subscribe and it downloads onto your phone, don't just play it, hit the cloud that actually downloads the episode. See, this shows you how stupid I am, right? So if I ever listen to one of our episodes to check it out, I would just hit it on my phone. And that's not a download. And the way we survive and thrive and give you guys all this content and keep investing is by getting downloads. So when that thing pops up in your phone, literally click on the cloud so the episode downloads. Don't just play it. That's a John Fosco favor. I'm asking y'all. Thank you.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah, exactly, dude. Dude, it's rough out in the streets, Mo.
Top 10 podcasts. Learn how to download podcasts. Fucking love it. All right. Yeah. Can the podcast be stopped?
No, come on, man. The podcast.
Can't be stopped.